Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Hello. Gentlemen in the front row, good morning.
Hi.
How are you? It's nice to see such a wonderful crowd here this morning. I'm Margaret Lowe. I'm president of Atlantic Live. Welcome to this chapter of We the People, the first three words in the preamble to our Constitution, which effectively framed our founding fathers' big plan to create a more perfect union. And We the People, as many of you know, I've seen your faces before, is a series of conversations here at the Atlantic about civitas and the laws that bind us together. I think it's fair to say that the whole notion of a more perfect union seems a bit of an anachronism right now. This country is so polarized, and not just in Washington. College campuses are among the many places experiencing these very sharp divides, and just witness the recent confrontations at Middlebury, at Berkeley, over conservative speakers on campus. And these questions raise big, these events raise big questions about the future of free speech. And while student activism is nothing new, the ability to protect all points of view and all speech is decidedly challenged. Our guest this morning, Georgetown President Jack DeGioia, is no stranger to these issues, running a major university at this moment in time. We're going to welcome President DeGioia in a moment, but before we do, I do want to thank the American Federation of Teachers, our underwriter, for making this conversation and this series possible. And with that, I am delighted to introduce Mary Catherine Ricker. She's AFT's Executive Vice President, and invite you to say a few words. Mary Catherine.
Thank you so much, Margaret. Thank you. I am really pleased to welcome you all today and to have the American Federation of Teachers be a part of this. I want to thank The Atlantic very much and Steve Clemons for hosting this forum, and to President John DeGioia for being here for this conversation. AFT is a proud sponsor of this series because we have a real stake in the debate. As the largest higher education union in the United States, we represent more than 130,000 college faculty, professional staff, and graduate employees across the country. And it's not exactly breaking news to let you know or fill you in on the fact that college campuses have always been centers of discourse, dissent, and civil disobedience. Case in point, Georgetown University, where some of you will recall the leaders of the anti-Vietnam War movement who sought refuge on the hilltop in early 1971, sparking an activist culture that continues to this day. A spirit epitomized by the Georgetown grads currently organizing to be recognized for the work they do on campus. After the campus uprisings of those heady decades, sociologist Elaine Terrain actually predicted the student movement would replace the labor movement as a key driver of social progress and equality in the West. And as a union leader, I am happy to say that the labor movement is still alive and well and kicking and fighting, and so is the student movement. And the climate on campuses, especially after last fall's election, remains lively. I also want to slightly reframe the debate over campus civility and free speech away from the merits of safe spaces, trigger warnings, and microaggressions that tend to dominate the debate for very important reasons. But I think by over-focusing specifically on these worthy issues, we risk missing the bigger picture. The undermining of the very structures in which free speech occurs. I'm thinking here of assaults on academic freedom like the professor watch list, proposed legislation in Iowa demanding that professors disclose who they vote for as part of the application process, and the death threats received by our member, Olga Perez Cox in Orange County, for daring to disagree with the new president. In the white-hot glare of the new administration, we need to protect civility and open debate on campus, and we also need to safeguard and nurture a climate that is conducive to them. And we need to remember that while free speech from professors, students, and staff is inviolable, outside speakers are invited guests, and protest is free speech as well. So I'll leave you with that thought and hand it back over to Margaret to introduce our very timely conversation for today. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Mary Catherine, and I think everybody in this room agrees that civil and conversation is part of what draws us all together here today. So a quick, much more practical note, if everyone would please silence your cell phones, don't put them away because we would love you to tweet. Our hashtag is WeThePeopleATL. And now, Jack DeGioia is the 48th president of Georgetown University. He's had that job for 16 years. He knows the place intimately. He went to college there, graduate school there, and taught there long before he became president. And he is here to talk, as we've been saying, about the delicate and often difficult balancing act confronting many university students, faculty, and administrators. Please welcome Jack DeGioia, here with to talk to my colleague, Washington Editor-at-Large Steve Clemons. Take it away, gentlemen.
Thank you so much, Margaret. Thank you. Thank you. Those were very impressive and moving remarks. So, Jack, thanks so much for joining us, and thanks to everybody here. And we'd like to, I'm going to have a little bit of a conversation here and then involve all of you. I know there's a lot going on out in the world of academia, free speech, higher education. When Jack DeGioia and I were at a conference in New York, it seems like about 9 months ago now, or before all of the stuff that's in the news, we were talking about some of these issues we're going to get into today, and they seemed to be so much easier to deal with then, but you told me, we were talking about, you know, how hard it was to, we were talking about what Georgetown had stepped forward on some of the with the descendants of those that had been slaves that had been sold as part of the endowment of Georgetown, what they had done. We talked a little bit about some of the tough decisions that came by way of free speech and how hard that was. And since then, there's been a lot on these fronts. And so, Jack, I remember my political science professor said, you really never know the norms of a system until you really witness it under stress. And so how are the norms of our political system doing under stress? And how are the norms at Georgetown doing under stress?
Well, that's a great question, Stephen. Thank you. And it may have felt like 9 months ago, but I think it was late October when we had that conversation. I think all in all, the norms are holding pretty well. We have challenges, as you are witnessing across the nation, as we try to find that appropriate balance between providing for the widest possible range of speech and expression, and ensuring civility and respect for the dignity of all of our people. I think the general commitment to the widest range of speech and expression is holding very strongly, but it is under considerable pressure given some of the more significant challenges that have emerged on specific campuses.
Do you hear from trustees after you make some, say you had, I don't know. I went back to read a program speech you did on free expression in 2003, and you had brought some provocative folks in. Do you hear from trustees who threaten you on your decisions?
No. I think we've worked very hard over a long period of time. To put in perspective, right. as we heard just a moment ago, I've been part of the university community for 42 years.
Right.
In the mid 1980s, we made a decision that we were going to capture the deepest commitments we had to the freedom of speech and expression in a set of policies that would guide the university community. We put that in place formally in 1989, and it has served to guide us. We do not limit speech, either on the content of the view or...
Give us the North Star in that.
We do not limit speech, either on the content of the view or the person expressing the view, and conducting, being able to provide a context for that commitment requires a community that respects, consistent with the spirit of the First Amendment, reasonable time, place, and manner restrictions. So anyone in our community can invite anyone to come and speak. And usually it's those moments which are the most challenging for anyone in my role. And I will hear from members of our community, why did you allow this person or why did you allow that person? We don't limit either on the content or on the person expressing the views. Now, when we have a particularly controversial speaker, we may do other things, provide other kinds of programming to ensure that a full range of perspectives are heard. But our thought, our response always to challenging speech is more speech.
So what do you, we just had this incident happen, I mean, almost perfect for today in a way, in Middlebury College, where Charles Murray was brought in to speak. And it turned into a violent protest where they had even built in a respondent. Well, you know, the Atlantic frequently does this as well. We pride ourselves on having 360-degree discussions. We bring in people from different points of view. But in this, they did that. And yet the protest went very violent. Peter Beinart in the Atlantic profiled it for those of you who'd like to read a bit more about this subject. And he wrote really a letter to liberals and said, we liberals can't allow this to happen, that we have to defend the right of everyone to speak. And I'm just wondering, what's the temperature at Georgetown in that, because I know you've recently had similar kinds of situations.
Sure, sure. Again, I think there's a profound depth to the commitment. If you think about the very idea of the university, there are, and particularly in the American context, there are a core set of values that have animated us from our founding. First and foremost is a commitment to academic freedom. That means the members of our faculty are free to pursue the truth wherever it leads them. One of our colleagues who has described this, Stefan Kleene, described this as the ungovernable play of the inquiring mind. Mm. And part of the responsibility of a university leadership is to ensure we protect the framework for academic freedom. This is the pursuit of truth in one's discipline, wherever that may lead. In addition to that, we're committed to the freedom of speech and expression. Mm. That's also deeply held as a core value in, on our campuses. We have other values. Shared governance would be another value that really animates us. We have a deep foundation on which to draw as we're wrestling with this latest set of challenges. But I've personally, and we as a university, have wrestled with these year in and year out for as long as I've been a part of the university community. Some of those previous incidents could be instructive in this moment. Let me give you one. In the mid-1980s, before we actually wrote this policy, we had, and let me set a little bit more context for those who don't know Georgetown very well. We're the oldest Catholic and Jesuit university in the United States. We were founded in 1789. Our founder, Archbishop John Carroll, became an archbishop after he founded Georgetown. We thought that was the reward. But Bishop Carroll was trained in Europe, in the heart of the Enlightenment, and brought those values to Georgetown when we were founded. So we were founded as a fusion of Catholic values and Enlightenment values. And the idea that we would be open to the free exchange of ideas goes all the way back to our founding. Mid-80s, we were, context piece. 1978, our president, Father Timothy Healy, flew to San Salvador and gave an honorary degree to Oscar Romero. And it was a very intentional act to show solidarity and support with the Catholic Church in El Salvador at a very difficult time. 2 years later, Oscar Romero was murdered on the very altar where that honorary degree ceremony took place. So a few years later, in the mid-1980s, some of our community invited Roberto Dobuisson of the Arena Party in El Salvador to campus. There were close links to what unfolded in El Salvador and the role that Mr. Dobuisson had played in their country. Protecting that forum was a very challenging moment for us. And so there are two chapters to this. So the first chapter was when he came to campus, or when he was planning to come to campus, we recognized that the security costs would be enormous. And we said to the sponsoring group, this will be the bill, that they couldn't afford it. So it essentially blocked him from speaking. Right. That's not the way in which we intend to manage the forum at our place. So as we wrote these policies in the late 80s, we said, look, you are responsible for the cost of security, but no one would be blocked from being able to speak due to the cost of security. So he was invited back, and we did protect the forum. And it was very, very difficult for us, because here we had, I think, the most vocal critics of allowing him to speak came from our own Jesuit community on campus. But we protected that forum, and we allowed him to speak. And that gives you a little bit of a sense of how seriously we take
this
responsibility.
No, it's tough. I mean, you're preserving your credibility. I'm thinking about the media, the Atlantic, and how so many things are done that are often hard decisions to protect that. But you and I have spent some time with Richard Edelman, and some of you may know Edelman and the Edelman Trust Barometer. And Richard Edelman has shown that basically every year for 17 years has been this solid decline in trust in institutions, trust in the media, trust in corporations, trust in you guys. And it just feels like the world is just eroding into a gutter when you look at Richard's stuff. And maybe I'm overstating it, but I know that you worry about this, and you worry about that erosion of trust. If you were all powerful, what would you do to go out and restore that trust in a place? Because I know that it's hitting Georgetown as well.
Well, you know, I think how we all respond, and I think, honestly, the response at Middlebury, President Patton's letter to the university community on Friday, that restores trust. It reminds everyone of the values that animate the community. This morning, in addition to Peter's piece, Dr. Murray had a piece on the AEI website describing his experiences there. This is a moment that demands the very best of all of us and all of our institutions. And if we can demonstrate the commitment that we have to the deepest values that we have, that have animated us and guide us, if we can do that in this moment, I think it will help to restore trust. But let me tell you what's at stake in this, Steve, because you know, Richard came to town and presented the Edelman Trust Barometer on our campus recently,
right,
and presented it to the Washington community. And he would describe, after 17 years of this barometer, trust is in crisis. All of us, we're all at the lowest point that we have been. The reason why I think this is so pernicious for the narrative about higher education is higher education has never been more urgent for more and more of our people. Let me put a little bit of perspective on it. 11.6 million jobs were created from January 2010 to January 2016. 11.6 million jobs in America. Net, 80,000 of those jobs went to high school graduates. Two-thirds of all new jobs created in America require post-secondary education. There's virtually no unemployment with a college degree. That doesn't mean it isn't challenging. The average young person will change jobs 5 times in 10 years. They're not achieving financial independence until age 31. It's a volatile, difficult, challenging environment for all of our young people. But if you don't have post-secondary education, it is brutally difficult to be able to move your way through in this moment. Every year, 400,000 kids score in the top half of the SAT or ACT. And if you look at them 10 years later, they will not have a post-secondary degree.
Do you support the career education movement?
Absolutely.
So that will count for you. Because there is this line.
Absolutely.
That, you know, Peter Thiel talks about, hey folks, you brilliant divas out there, drop out and make your own way. Is Peter helping or hurting that problem?
Well, I don't think it helps the overall narrative, which is one that is eroding trust in higher education. But I think, you know, Peter's project is one that focuses on some incredibly gifted prodigies, essentially. And I don't think that is something that should distract us from the most important set of issues that we confront, which is ensuring ever more access, ever more opportunity for our young people.
You recently had Asra Namani speak, and Asra Namani is a woman, a Muslim, I think an Iranian American, who wrote a piece for a variety of reasons, principally healthcare, why she supported Donald Trump. And one of your faculty members, Christine Fair, sort of lit into her on Twitter. A lot of vulgarity and whatnot. I guess vulgarity is protected by free speech too. But she spoke on campus, and I heard from a lot of students, knowing that you were going to speak here, about this incident, and I sort of dug into it. And you had the program, it seemed to go well, but I sort of felt what I was missing, and I may have been getting a sort of a limited set, is I had conservative groups at Georgetown writing to me about Ms. Namani. I didn't have liberal groups at Georgetown writing to me, saying we need to protect everyone's right. Is there, Is there a view that if you're a conservative group, you're going to support conservative speakers and liberals are going to support liberals, that the groups on campus are captured by perspective and passion and they're not really capturing that broader principled commitment and something's getting missing in the advocacy for these speakers?
Yeah, it's a great question. And, you know, I don't doubt that there are very strong advocates for particular positions in our student body who will ensure certain speakers are a part of the discourse in our community. But you know, I've been a part of it for 40 plus years, and I've seen lots of different ways in which students are really engaged in trying to understand their thoughts, their positions. We've had the widest range of people come to campus over the course of the last months. We've run a series through our McCourt School of Public Policy, the exit interviews. Mm. You would have loved these. These are members of cabinet coming to campus and offering perspective to our community. And if you've ever come to our campus and experienced the visit of a distinguished speaker, you will see that a level of engagement, civility, and seriousness of purpose of our students. The Q&A in Gaston Hall is among one of the most extraordinary experiences you could have. And so I do think, as I said earlier, this is a moment that demands the very best of everyone, and I'm confident that we will see that.
You know, Jack, part of the spirit of this series and We the People is built around this notion of civitas, of that we can have struggles, we don't have to be all warm and fuzzy and kind, that we can struggle, but we're all in the same boat, we're all under the same roof at the end of the day, and there's got to be mutual respect built into those debates. And I'm wondering about how to go back, you know, restill it. And I heard this wonderful story, and I guess I'll share this. I met a member of the Saudi royal family who was an ambassador once. I won't mention his name, but he was a student at Georgetown. He was a student of Father Healy's. And he took a class with him, and that in this class, he had to, the students were divided up, and they had to take positions on the Middle East peace process that was the opposite of what they believed. So he had to write the Israeli case during, you know, for the Middle East peace. He says, and you can see it in his face, the pain that still wandered with him. He said it was the most painful, difficult thing he'd ever done. But he said it was the most important thing that he'd ever done, and for his diplomacy. And so, the Jewish and Israeli students, American Jewish students, did the same thing, taking the Middle East. And I'm wondering whether we did this with Randy Weingarten from AFT and a proponent of charter schools and privatization, and asked them to change seats. We got them to change seats and argue the best points of each other's position. Is that kind of thing silly or trite, or do you think there are things that we can do that actually get people out of just broadcasting their position more loudly and actually engaging and thinking and trying to think through the merits of the other side? Is that missing in our schools? Because I sort of think something's missing.
Yeah, no, I don't think it's missing. I think where it's missing is it's harder to do that in a more public context. But I think you would find in the context where the ambassador was a student, he would find that a similar kind of dynamic today. We provide in our community, we still have the Center for Contemporary Arab Studies, which would have been part of the pull that would have brought him to Georgetown. I think I know who you're referring to, and we were just a year or two apart. What would have brought him to Georgetown in the 1970s, early 80s, would have been the fact that we had established the first Center for Contemporary Arab Studies in the United States. It was the leading place to study the Arab world.
Right.
But over the years, just to put in perspective, we were the first Catholic university in 1968 to have a full-time rabbi. We're the first American university to have a full-time imam. We established a Center for the Study of Jewish Civilization over the last years. And just last year, we established the leading center for the forensic study of the Holocaust. Mm. In our community, you have the opportunity to be able to pull from those resources and try to establish your framework for engaging the world.
Are you worried at all by the discussion of a post-fact society or post-fact politics? You know, that we're here in Washington, you educate students in Washington, but we've got a debate going on about fundamental rationality, empirical evidence, and science going on right now. Are you worried?
Yeah, very much so. But if we put this in an academic context, know that this is an arc of about 40 plus years that we've been engaged in terms of trying to come to terms with the Enlightenment, the results of the Enlightenment, the success of the Enlightenment, our commitment to truth, our understanding of truth, and some of the very practices of the university. Mm-hmm. For example, let's just focus on science for a minute. The national academies have been under some political pressure in recent years. Well, the very model that we embody, which is we pursue the truth, we do everything we can to understand the deepest levels of reality as we possibly can reach. Mm-hmm. We then share that. But remember, in our context, it's always provisional. Mm. It's always subject to another scholar, another researcher coming along saying, wait a minute, I found something here. It's a little bit different than that. Well, when we do that, it sort of questions, well, what did you think you had in the first place? Is truth part of the inherent structure of reality, or is it a social construction? Mm-hmm. Of course, it's both. In science, we really work to discover what is the inherent structure of our world. In our social lives, we are building the framework for that. And that's what social science and the humanities contribute to.
So if President Trump were a student of yours, Jack, what would you share with him?
I'd love to have him in my seminar. I taught one a year ago on truth. It was called Telling Truth. And basically, we try to look at how do you establish truth claims in the natural sciences, the social sciences, and the humanities? What enables you to have confidence you're in possession of the truth? And then what do you do when you come into challenges to what you possess? How do you make your case? How do you defend the positions that you have? We believe that in a dialectic, in a dialogue, mm-hmm. as rigorous as we can be, together we can arrive at the truth. And in that process, together.
I hope President Trump's people are watching right now. I'd love to see him in a seminar with you. It would be great. That's my new goal now, to make this happen. Jack, before I go to the audience, because I want to open this up, there's lots of folks that have questions here for you. I'm also very interested in your taking on the challenge of dealing with the historical decisions made, some ugly ones relating to the selling of slaves that became part of the endowment, building buildings and fulfilling things. It was clearly a different era, but as Ta-Nehisi Coates has written powerfully in the pages of The Atlantic, there's a lot of this burden and a lot of this legacy that exists in our institutions, in our cities, in our businesses that were built on the backs and lives of Africans, African Americans. And I'm interested in what you did, why you did it, how's it going?
Sure, thank you very much. And Ta-Nehisi and I had an opportunity to have this kind of conversation not too long ago, so it's a privilege to be able to continue it with you. So the Georgetown story is one we've known for a long time, and we've taught it for a long time. In 1838, Georgetown was the beneficiary of a sale of 272 enslaved women, children, and men on plantations that the Jesuit order had in Maryland. And the person responsible for that sale had previously served as the president of the university. And the university's connection to it is twofold. One, we had a building on campus named for him.
Right.
And second, of the proceeds of the sale, about $17,000 in 1838 money came to the university. And, I forget the current value of that, but
it's not small.
If I remember correctly, it's about $500,000 or something. Right. But the point is, it was very important at the time. Mm. More importantly, the university benefited through that sale by the institution of slavery. We've taught that story. We actually had our first digital website in the mid-90s put the documents of the sale online for people to be able to see. We were renovating a building 2 years ago, and the building we were renovating had a name on it. It was the name of this individual, Father Thomas Milady, who in his time was a giant among the leadership of the Catholic Church. So we began a project as we were getting ready to open that building, where we put together a working group on slavery, memory, and reconciliation. Mm-hmm. And we wanted to come to terms with what it meant for us to have that part of our history, alive with us today. What did it mean for us to engage that part of our history? The working group began its work in September of 2015, and they gave their report in September of 2016. Along the way, we were surprised by two things. One was how few of our community really knew the story. It was never something we had hidden, but it was not something that had been fully embraced as part of the understanding of who we are. And second, while we were on this journey, a number of descendants expressed an interest in connecting with us. And so we went out, and I went out to meet with descendants in Washington State, and then in New Orleans, and Baton Rouge, and Maringouin, Louisiana, where many of the original enslaved women, children, and men were brought.
And what was the tone?
Oh, it was incredible. Mm. It was an incredible blessing for me personally to be able to engage in conversations with folks where what we share in common is trying to understand profoundly how we can use this experience, this history of this university, the connection of these individuals through their families, and the work that we as a university can be engaged in this moment to try to understand our responsibilities. Along the way, we also launched another project. I presented an address in February of 2016 on racial justice in America, a Georgetown response, in which we looked very seriously at what could we do as a university in this moment to address the fact that part of what we're wrestling with in America today is the legacy of never having addressed, never having resolved the original evil of slavery in the mid part of the 19th century. We never ameliorated the effects of the original evil. And so consequently, we wrestle with those today. This summer, we just issued a report from our Center for Health Disparities, which is located right here in the city near the Navy Yard.
Right.
If you're white, I'm black, in the city of Washington in 2016, your life expectancy as a white male is 15 years longer than mine.
Hmm.
And I'll be six times more likely to suffer from diabetes. Mm-hmm. That's today. We could take you across a range of issues: wealth creation, housing, employment opportunities. We're living with the legacies of slavery and subsequent segregation in this moment. And the challenge for Georgetown, and why this has been such an incredible opportunity for us to engage this set of questions, is it is enabling us to discover how to be a new kind of university engaging these questions in a new kind of way.
And you have made a deal with these descendants, as I understand it, where they can come to the college, can come to Georgetown.
Well,
yeah.
As a private,
I have that wrong?
Just a little bit.
Okay.
I can correct it, though.
Usually I am.
No.
A little bit wrong.
You're close enough, though. Mm. I know what you're referring to. As a private university, we've always provided very special care and attention to those who have an enduring relationship with our community.
Right.
I'm referring specifically to the children of our faculty and staff and to those alumni who have sustained a very deep engagement with the institution. Right. And what that means is, at the time of admissions, we look very carefully to determine whether or not, all things being equal, there's something there to pay special attention to. What I described when we presented the report in September of this past fall, we intend to give the same care and attention to the children of descendants. As we've been out on this journey, we've discovered some descendants are alumni.
Oh.
So it's been fun to it's been, as
so
I said.
So you've already got those boxes.
Two boxes checked.
Hey, can I just, you know, and again, just to, we'll go to all of you in just a moment, but I was very taken with this set of remarks you gave in February 2003. So what is that, 14 years ago? They seem to capture the tension today so well. I don't know if you've read, I'll give you a copy of your own speech. But in it, you know, you open it arguing both against a wide aperture on free speech and then very much strongly providing the argument for a wide aperture on free speech. You write, universities are predicated on a fundamental trust that permits the broadest possible intellectual freedom and autonomy. Universities are also committed to the idea that the truth is achieved in dialogue. To limit dialogue a priori is to show a lack of confidence in the capacity of the individual to discover truth. The university is a catalyst and container of conflict, and there will be conflict. Active debate and discussion of ideas are, in fact, the signs of a healthy intellectual community. I love this paragraph, and I feel it, but I also know it's really, really, really hard to live that way. And I'm interested, when you sort of, you're Georgetown, you're an Ivy League, you know, you're like up there in the you know, the grandpapas of schools. What do you tell the smaller liberal arts schools where this is going on all over the country? I'm just sort of interested, when you don't have the resources of Georgetown, the stature of Georgetown, what guidance can you give some of the smaller places that are all struggling with this on how they can, what's the shortcut to actually helping them stand by these sorts of principles? Because I think it's tough for them.
Well, it is tough for everyone, and I would not want to suggest for a moment that I would be able to offer advice to anyone else regarding the dynamics within their community. But what I would say is this, Steve, there are a core set of values that define who we are as colleges and universities. Take away those values and we're no longer colleges or universities. I mentioned three of them so far: our commitment to academic freedom, our commitment to speech and expression, our commitment to shared governance. You take those things away we will not be able to sustain the very idea of the university. It's not about prestige or wealth or selectivity or what your stature is. It's about who you are, what you are as an institution, and the values that animate you. And I would believe that every place struggles to sustain those values. The speech that you're given was, I did that in the start of my middle of my second year in this job, and part of it was to explain how I intended to handle some challenging moments like the ones we're experiencing now, which is to keep the forum open. But this is a contested idea, and one of our most distinguished faculty, I asked her to essentially debate me that day. I gave a thought experiment. If we were to limit, if we weren't, and why I came down on why we don't limit. But she had very good arguments for the other side, and I tried to explain.
Who won out in the end? I guess you did, Mr. President.
Well, we've sustained the forum. And by the way, I have profound respect for these arguments. It's not as if I don't believe that they aren't authentic in their deep commitment to them. It's just that in the context of a university, we take away this ability for freedom. We take away our ability to perform our roles for society.
Thank you. Let me open up the floor to questions, comments, folks. Here we go. Stacey, you have this gentleman right here.
You're going to hold the mic? Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks very much. This question maybe is a sort of follow-up to Steve's last question. I wanted to ask if you could get a little more concrete on
Can you identify yourself, please?
Sure. John DiPaolo. Okay. On the question of what is to be done. So a president of a hypothetical university comes to you and says, you know, I've got a bunch of students who believe that when they shut down the speech of an invited speaker whom they object to, they feel like they're engaging in a highly moral action. They're preventing psychic harm to their classmates, and they're engaging in civil disobedience that has a, you know, it's a direct descendant of the civil rights movement. This is really doing good in the world. Yeah. And they have the power to stand up during a presentation and make it impossible for someone to speak. So the president says to you, concretely, President, what can I do to try to change this?
Great question.
It's what we live with truly every day. If I take a little bit more nuance in trying to describe the context that we're wrestling with, imagine a four quadrants in a grid, and the horizontal axis is speech, and at one end it's limited, at the other end it is it's expansive, and then imagine the vertical axis capturing another dimension, and that other dimension is what's often at stake here. In the higher ed context, for roughly the last 20 plus years, that axis has pretty much been defined by harassment. that what we've had an evolving law in our country regarding what is appropriate for people to be able to say and do and in their conversations, in their work, in the workplace, in the residences, and the like. So we're always trying to find this balance between, well, we're trying to harmonize our policies on speech and expression and our policies on harassment. Now, as you no doubt are already thinking, well, you could label it other things, and others will label this other things. You could label it in a softer way, perhaps diversity. In a harsher way, you could label it hate speech. Depending on how you map out the dynamics that you're wrestling with, you'll also find, you know, what space on that in those four quadrants that you might find yourself. For example, in the lower right quadrant, you find almost all of our public institutions because they're required essentially by law to uphold the First Amendment. You'll find many of our private institutions that take the exact same position. You'll find organizations that track these issues, like FIRE is one that would be in the bottom right quadrant. Brown, just a week or two ago, had Jeff Stone on campus, probably our most distinguished First Amendment lawyer, who was the architect of the Chicago principles. I think you'd find those in that bottom right quadrant. Go up to the top left. There's a whole lot of folks who believe that there is no place. I think you would be recognizing individuals like this in your example. Mm-hmm. There's no place to tolerate the intolerant. Mm. The anti-fascist movement in the U.S. thinks that the Europeans got this right after World War II. Not all speech should be protected. Fascist speech should not be protected. And they call the movement Antifa, the anti-fascists. And they'd be in the top left quadrant. You got a whole lot of folks, and I think most of the folks you were asking me about really are in that upper right, but probably sliding close to the bottom right, where they're trying to get the right balance, trying to be respectful to the diversity of their community, trying to be respectful to the law as we need to be, but also recognizing first principles. We do not limit speech, either on the content of the view or the person expressing the views. So if you're going to oppose a speaker, there's an appropriate way to do that, but if you block the speaker, that requires some form of institutional response. That's so your use of the term civil disobedience is quite appropriate, because usually it does involve some form of disciplinary response by an institution.
Sounds like we're gonna have a lot more of this. Yes, right here.
Hello, my name is George Raymond. I'm an independent researcher. Thank you for the discussion today. I guess I arrived at college in 2005, and having the conscience that I have now, I wouldn't have arrived, period. and I guess my question goes to, has any research been done on the expectations of students coming in for free speech, i.e. how they define free speech and what that expectation is? Because for me, in hearing the dialogue today and with what I know, it sounds like there is a marketing and branding rhetoric, and then the actual expectation. So in terms of free speech, when I hear free speech, there is free speech, First Amendment, the concept of free speech, and then there is the freedom to speak, which is individual courage versus something that is a political and populist bargaining chip. Free speech is always a political ideal versus the courage to stand and speak, freedom to speak.
So I'd encourage you. That great question, thank you. And that too could be a source of a longer conversation. But let me just give you a couple of ideas. To the Knight Foundation, formerly originated in the newspaper business, the Knight Ritter family. The Knight Foundation in Miami has been studying just this question over the last 2 years. In September, I moderated a panel of about 45 of my colleagues, where we reviewed the work of the Knight Foundation, who have studied the expectations of our students and how they regard speech. The key top line finding, our young people have more confidence in their speech and their speech rights than the adults in the communities do. I think some of that has to do, I think, with their own experiences through social media and expressing themselves. But there is a higher degree of confidence, I think well above 70%, very confident in their speech rights. But to your point, there is less confidence if you break it down by segments of our community, and our African American students have less confidence, particularly in their freedom of assembly. Less confidence in their freedom of assembly. But to your point on, yes, it's great to have this freedom, but if it requires a tremendous act of courage to be able to speak as one wishes, this is a dynamic that we're all wrestling with.
Got to bring it because we have a lot of folks watching online. No. I apologize for. But why don't you take it in response so that we can hear it on the streaming too?
We can keep going.
Okay, great. Yeah. Yes, right here.
Yes, my name is Roger Cochetti, and I am an alumnus. I happen to have been the student body president at Georgetown in 1971, at the time of the incident that was described earlier, and that incident actually illustrates the question I wanted to ask pretty well.
Did that bring you to power, Roger, or did it take you down?
Well, I guess it. There's no way to say it did anything but help me in understanding how the world works. But the situation that actually took place was the civil disturbance units were lined up in front of Healy Circle, and a couple hundred demonstrators had gone into the campus at that point. There was a cordon, and the police captain at the moment told me, as the student body president, that you guys had better disperse and not let anyone else on campus or we're coming in. Mm-hmm. Father Henley, your predecessor at the time, the university president, was a very conservative person, but also deeply committed to the same principles of free speech and actually sanctuary. But he made the decision at that moment that we would let no more demonstrators in and we would disperse. And in my discussions, or probably better described as arguments with him afterward, he explained that what he had to do was look out for the interests of the university. Yes, he had a commitment to sanctuary and comparable to the commitment to free speech, but there was a point at which he had to look out for the interests of the students. And although he didn't say it explicitly, he also had to look out for the interests of the donors, the foundations, the Department of Education grants, and everything else that he had to worry about.
Right.
I could not at that time have disagreed with him more, and we went on to create Students of Georgetown Corporation so that the student government would never not have property in the future that it could rely on. But the point is, with the benefit of 45 years hindsight, I believe he made the right decision. I believe that what he
did... Have you ever said that before, Roger?
I have not ever said that before. Father Henley's passed away. He would, somewhere he's up there smiling to hear me say that today. But I think the point is, I applaud you for your commitment to free speech. As I've gotten older, I've actually become more absolutist about it. But there was a point then, and there must be a point now. It's the flip side of the other question, where you have to say, you know what? Free speech, if it was a perfect world, I would let this person come in, but I have to think about the donors, I have to think about the grants, I have to think about the faculty recruitment, I have to think about student recruitment. So how do you deal with the real, I would encourage you,
thank you,
to be absolute, but on the other hand, you have to live in the real world too.
So he's asking for the politician side of you, Jack.
No, I think you already know my answer, but I also think you give me an opportunity to say something with a little more precision that I haven't yet said, and that is about safety and security. So a fundamental premise of keeping the forum open is ensuring that we can provide for the safety and security of everyone who is present. And my experience now managing these things over 30 plus years, we have not had a moment where I did not feel we could provide for the safety and security of our community. If I felt that we could not, then we're in a different conversation, because I then can't permit speech if we can't provide for safety and security. You know, I I appreciate why you would ask the question, but I actually believe that when all is said and done, what our alumni community, our philanthropic supporters, what they expect is that I will preside over the university in my current role and adhere to the deepest principles that animate us, even when it's unpopular.
Mm-hmm. Yes, right here.
Good morning. My name is Travis York. I'm with the Association of Public and Land-Grant Universities. Thank you for your conversation today. I know that this is a topic that many presidents across the country really struggle with and many other university leaders. I'm wondering if you might comment a little bit. You've really kind of highlighted the struggle that university leaders have to embark in around free speech and safe and inclusive environments, and sometimes those priorities compete with each other. And you've really kind of nicely talked about how essential free speech is connected to the other values of higher education. I'm wondering if, in light of those values, and considering Secretary DeVos's recent comments at the CPAC meeting where she accused university leaders, and specifically university faculty, of telling students how to think, how to feel, and what to do. Sometimes I wish we could actually do that, but I'm wondering if you could speak more kind of about you know, those remarks and how institutions, you're advocating that it's essential that they provide academic freedom, but that's also in light of a policy context where they're being accused of not doing so at all.
Yeah. You know, my whole life has been lived in the academy. The foundational principles that we've been discussing in our conversation today, including academic freedom, provide respect for our students too. I don't know of any faculty member who would ever define their role as indoctrination. As faculty members, they have a vocation in which they are responsible for the formation of young people and exposing them to the practices of the academy. And those practices include the free exchange of ideas. And anyone denying a young person that experience is not conducting the work of a university. Go back.
Right here. Ma'am, you had your hand up? Yeah.
Hi, my name's Patrice Payne. I just wanted to ask, I am a proponent of free speech, but is there a point where you have to educate the students that there are limits to First Amendment?
Yes. I didn't get into the depth of the nuance of what are reasonable time, place, and manner restrictions. So any member of our community can request the use of a facility and can invite somebody to campus, and we will then provide the framework to allow that to occur. But some speakers can be so provocative that it does require a conversation with those inviting, but also with others in the university to ensure that we are providing a rich framework for the issues that are at stake in whatever provocation is being made at that moment. So it's a lot of attention does go into discussing what is the significance of this event? What is the meaning for our community of this event? Why are you bringing this person, this? Why are you making this event possible? What's the goal? What's the purpose? Recognizing that there will be others who may want to then respond with counter programming of certain kinds.
Well, I think it's also, you know, I know the people in Georgetown, in fact, I've been always fascinated by this yelling fire in a crowded theater court case, and you
that's
teach
where,
that. Yeah,
that's where time, place, and manner.
Right, right. Yes, right here.
Hi, thank you. My name's David Chavron. I represent the newspaper business, so you might expect what my views on free speech might entail, something of an extremist, I guess. But even in that context, I do wonder about what we see on college campuses, in particular the desire for safety, civility, those things that may be generationally harder for folks to understand compared to our own experiences. May be informed by the fact that they spend a lot of time on social platforms where the discourse is very unsafe, very uncivil, evil often, right? So you spend a lot of your life in digital realms where it's not civil at all. And that on a college campus, maybe this is the time where where maybe some of those expressions come from. They have full lives. Only one part of it is indicated on what's happening in college campuses. But we have to take into account on the social platforms, it can be awful.
A lot of bullying and Jack, comment.
I concur. It's a more complex context that we're wrestling with. Hold it. Let me see. There we go. It's a more complex
context. I got the
turbocharge. I'm ready to speak.
Yeah.
It's a more complex context today than it has been at any other time, partly because, not just because they're engaged in other kinds of conversations on social media, but that amplifies so many things that happen on our campuses. So we are wrestling with a new kind of context that is at the heart of, I think, your question.
One more, John.
Thank you very much, John and Steve, for coming to enlighten us. And I'm very impressed with the insight I got. My name is Andrew Green, and I'm representing Maryland United for Peace and Justice. My question is tailored towards the relationship between free speech in the current era and freedom of information, especially in the wave of telecommunications and new media. How do these expressions limit or expand the role of either freedom of speech or freedom of information? And where do we have limitations on the two, especially if people face a lot of cyberbullying and other things? How do we relate the two?
Oh, I see where you're going. If we go back to the grid that I was describing earlier, and again, that vertical grid where it's not clear how you might label it. And I was using harassment and harassment law as part of what we've tried to balance. When we get into issues of bullying and really inappropriate behaviors that are manifesting themselves in different ways, there are expectations that individuals, families, communities would have of us to step in and try to address inappropriate behavior. So it is a new, it's very much connected to the last question. It is a new context that we're wrestling with. It demands that we find new and creative ways of trying to respond. But again, in a context where our predisposition is to ensure the free exchange of ideas, where we see inappropriate behavior, cyberbullying and the like, we know we have responsibilities to act. And the question is, if there's a blurring in those issues, that's what requires the real work of leadership.
Jack, can I just end this? I don't know if I can frame this question very well, but it's something that's been itching in my head, and that is, I sort of feel that one of the things going on in the country right now is a backlash to elitism in the political parties, elitism in institutions, a sense that lots of people don't have a track into that, and that people born into wealth and privilege and access just have the cards on their side and lots of other folks don't. And I know that there are limits to your power, but what you do, but I'm interested in, at one of these, what do you think needs to be done to, blur some of that, to kind of make people feel as if, and it give them genuine opportunities to be part of that. But I mean, one, I don't know if you agree with me that there's a kind of growing elitism and a backlash to that, but I'm just sort of interested in what those that are part of those elite institutions or perceived elite institutions, what they feel like their responsibility is to get the social contract back in shape again, if you will, for everyone.
It's a fantastic question and a lead in to another full hour of conversation, but you're—
We always like to leave you wanting more.
You are on a very, very important question. What the trust barometer challenges about institutions, there really is a lack of trust in authority and institutions. And I don't think if we go back to earlier in our conversation, what we need to understand, where we need to understand deeply the significance of the responsibilities we have for our young people. So I said a moment ago, 2/3 of all new jobs will require post-secondary education. Well, that means, well, let me say another word about it. Only 40+% just over 40% of our population have a 2-year or 4-year degree.
Right.
So we are not, 32% have a 4-year degree, roughly 8% have a 2-year degree. It's growing a little bit, but we have the highest high school graduation rates in our history. We're over 80% high school graduation. We haven't moved the needle significantly on post-secondary in our lifetimes. Hmm. 2/3 of all new jobs will require post-secondary. 1/3 won't. Hmm. But that 1/3 needs a whole different level of preparation than we're currently able to provide for. I said earlier there are only 80,000 jobs that, that were... Well, that was a net number. If we break it down, the area in that in the range of high school jobs that where there was growth was highly specialized.
Right.
You know, highly specialized skill-based jobs that require a different kind of training than we're providing right now. So we need to be thinking very carefully across the entire spectrum how we can get more and more of our young people to pursue more and more education. And then for those for whom that is not going to make sense in their lives, we have to come up with other ways of attending to them. The social contract that we need to build, that we need to restore in our nation, is the responsibility we have for our young people. And if you look at the level of public support for our public institutions, we could have a full conversation on the level of 1975, 2/3 of the operating budgets for our public and land-grant universities in the United States came from state budgets. Today, it's in the 30s. And for our flagships, it's in the single digits. This is the moment where we need to be investing ever more in our young people. And we play a role in that, and we need to get better and better at what we do, but we also need, as a nation, to take responsibility for our young people.
Thank you. Mary Catherine, I want to say, first of all, thank you, because this, the American Federation of Teachers has sponsored this series. This is the kind of conversation that we are really proud of. Thank you so much, Jack DeGioia from Georgetown University, for helping us understand what equities we have in this. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Thanks, Jack.